In 1940 and 41, countless railings were torn out of London's streets and squares as part of the war effort. They were, it was announced, to be melted down and forged as weaponry. In fact, what happened was that they were dumped in the Thames estuary off Sheerness. Still, this act of casual vandalism was reckoned to be a great morale booster. Portsmouth is the most lavishly defended city in Britain. Does it then follow that its populace feels safer than that of, say, Southampton? Maybe. But its defences are for the entire nation. We can all sleep easy because of them. The realm defends its loyal subjects. It has to defend them, for who else will defend the realm? It was always thus. There was always a flawed compact between the state and its potential cannon fodder. The state conscripts or press gangs. It persuades the people of imminent danger. It persuades them that Armageddon is a mere 45 minutes away.
Rome sends her legions into the furthest corners of the discovered world, and her ships are crowding English waters. Some of them are pushing up into a lonely creek on the south coast of Britain, in Hampshire. In this natural harbour, a fort is built.
Portsmouth physically charts the history of British xenophobia. It's an anthology of responses to scares. It's a monument to diplomatic failures, to the persistence of nationalism, to unneighbourliness, and also to royal covetousness and the boorishness of the state. Portchester Castle established the template, not merely for the fortifications themselves, but for the unlovely state of mind and conduct that they represent. It was originally Roman, one of the Saxon shore fortresses. It is, however, not on the seashore, but on that of the northern side of the harbour. Like many of its successors, it was apparently intended to defend the harbour against attack from land. Most of what remains today is of the 12th and 14th centuries. What does not remain is the Augustinian monastery, which occupied part of the outer bailey. The dissolution of the monasteries was undertaken not merely to quash papal power in this country. It was also an act of grand larceny, a state crime of exceptional proportions. Land and buildings and treasures were plundered by the crown and sold to courtly sycophants and ambitious placemen. This was the foundation of such great estates as Wilton. And Henry VIII used the money that he had thus acquired to build a series of fortresses to repel the enemies he had made, establishing the first church of the obese polygamist, now trading as the Church of England. Portsmouth is a bastion which contains bastions, a Russian doll of a place. There are fortresses everywhere. They're extraordinarily public. They advertise their massive and now incongruous presence. They're reassuring in a way that an invisible electronic device could never be. humankind's perception of the means of defence is nowhere near so advanced as our invention of those means. We respond to the physical, to the literal. The graphically fortified and the visibly tough appeal to our primitive senses. So barbed wire, Rottweilers and human apes with no necks will always have it over hidden gadgets.
Anything about them. I mean, as far as I was concerned, I've been brought up here all my life, but as far as I was concerned, it's just a pile of bricks with the grass on top. You know, it was just, they'd just always been here. The thought of actually living in it just never occurred to me. Well, I was through my interest with medieval longbows. I needed to do some research, and there was some archive here that I needed to look at. And I got to know the custodian, and she mentioned that the flat was coming available. So I put my name down and got it. It's got an atmosphere about the place that's unlike anywhere else. And once you've been involved with the place, I think anybody that's involved with it closely, you kind of fall in love with the place a little bit. You can be as loud as you want. You've got no neighbours to worry about. Play music as loud as you like. And probably the worst thing is front door keys.
This unparalleled concentration of fortresses is a monument to several centuries' Francophobia. Here is fear made brick. These structures are the architectural manifestations of paranoia. The last fortresses to be built are little more than a century and a quarter old. They were not completed till the 1870s. They belong approximately to the age of Dickens's greatest works and the Crystal Palace and HMS Warrior. Yet their true contemporaries were built centuries before them. They're throwbacks, hugely costly throwbacks devised for several reasons. Lord Palmerston was over 70 when he became Prime Minister in 1855. He was then possessed of first-hand memories of years of war with France. He had entered the House of Commons as the member for Rottenborough only 2 years after Trafalgar. As Foreign Secretary in the 1830s and 40s, he was an enthusiastic meddler in the affairs of other countries. He pursued what would today be euphemised as preemptive actions. He did so because he considered them to be in the British interest, but also because he conceived of Britain as a prefect in the playground of viciously childish nations. Fire! The six fortresses along Portsdown Hill are known to this day as Palmerston's Follies. Their primary purpose was, supposedly, to protect the city from a landward invasion, the thinking being that the French would not dare land a force at Portsmouth, but might do so at some unspecified and weakly defended point along the coast and then make their way over land. This was, to say the least, a far-fetched prospectus. The MP, Richard Cobden, recognised that Palmerston was pathetically prey to the fears of his long-distant youth. There is not an officer who is under 50 who does not look with supreme contempt, disgust and humiliation at these works. 140 years on, I guess we are less inclined to be so censorious. Yesterday's folly is today's, well, folly. But in a different sense.